So, but, ew. So, and, so, so, and, so, roll the intro. Let's do some motherfucking mathematics, baby. I think I just found my new presentation room. Look at that. Like I'm Rama fucking Nugent in here. Unbelievably tropical.
Acoustics a little bit echoey. I haven't done a classroom review of this classroom yet. This has gotta be an 8 out of 10. You got this like 30 foot IMAX screen there. It's phenomenal. But that has nothing to do with this video. We are doing a mathematical history lesson. Just kind of the broad pattern I noticed having read a few math history books that'll may save you some time. Because I was reading a lot of math and I was wondering to myself, what the hell is this? What am I doing? Like, what's actually happening here? What's going on? What's the point? Like, it's a bunch of stuff, and is there some gestalt idea of what's happening? Yes, there is, and I will show it to you on that board.
Math. Why? As I dove into mathematics, the problem that came up for me was, what is happening here? What are we doing? What's the main goal? How do we even say what math is? I used to think it was just numbers and stuff, but then it starts getting super hairy, and you start getting all these different weird words, and it's all like jumbled up, and it's like, what? What are we doing here? And so that's what I'm gonna try to answer today, in this episode. Math. We're humans, so we start with human reason. We're going, right? We're pondering, we're like, so just imagine a dude on a rock back in the day, he's like pondering, and he's looking at some tiles. This is actually very interesting. It's said that the Pythagorean theorem may have actually come out about this, because back in the day, they had, in ancient Greece, they had a really complicated tilings. That was the thing they did. So they had these complicated tile patterns, and they'd make different shapes and fit them together. So it is not a huge cognitive jump to say, well, maybe they were cutting up tiles, and they had some right triangles they were trying to fit with some squares. And, you know, they're playing around. They have to cut it out of a big rectangle tile. And they're like, after about 1,000 of these, because they're doing a whole palace or something, they're like, seems like when you have the triangle, and then you have a square here, and a square here, and a square here, that when you cut it out of a big tile, it seems that a squared plus b squared, the square tile here and the square tile here, has the same area as the square tile here. And that is possibly how the actual Pythagorean theorem came about. And that's just an example of how environment can lead to mathematics. So we have some thing, we observe it, and we have to have some representation of that thing in like a rigorous way, so it's like numbers, a squared, b squared, c squared. It's like this, it's an abstraction from the environment. So you start with environment. Right? Environment. Pardon my terrible writing. And then, right, you have some math representing your environment, so the Pythagorean theorem is a simple example. And then, because we're ponderers, we're reasoners, after some time, this starts building up. This process, you start going like, right, people are like, a bunch of different theorems. Circles could do certain things. Euclid comes along, he makes a bunch of different theorems from base axioms saying like, if you draw circles this certain way, you can make a hexagon that's perfect with angles, and you can prove it. And there's a bunch of different stuff like that, or you observe that like, if you fire a cannon at this angle this far, it'll certainly do this, given a bunch of stuff that's like some calculus stuff for you. And this is, it's all over the map. Math starts all over the map, but then we're just gonna kind of a fake history, but this works. This is pretty close to what real history is. It like maps on very well. Very, very good mental heuristic. It's just come up with like a history that could have happened, so you understand the cognitive development, and then you're gonna go back and be like, okay, well, because yeah, it gets all hairy, but whatever. So you have this, you have a big body of mathematics, and then, say you're a professor or whatnot, or you're a guy that's just goaded with the mathematical sauce, you have a bunch of math now pondering in your head, instead of just examples of tiles, and you now have a bunch of examples of math. And you're observing some structure in math, and you're like, you see a bunch of different instances of the same structure. They're a bit different, it's like there's different tiles, but there seems to be some pattern among the tiles that you're like, the mathematical tiles, so this could be like, what's a good example? Like functions, I guess, or it's tough to come up with like a, I'm gonna try to keep it simple. I don't wanna bring up like any complicated mathematical structures, but it makes sense once you get in it, because if you're playing around with this level of math, it's like, after a while, you're like, you're a reasoner. So you're like, another level comes out of it. So this is a higher level. So instead of just going down to environment, it sees math and makes a higher level theory of math. And this tower just keeps going up. And so now you have things like, take the isomorphism from a abelian group onto its something whatever, and it gets all like, what are we doing here? But the problem is you have to kind of start here, go there, and then it starts making sense as you go up, but a lot of time it's not explained well. And that's just what we're dealing with on the ground. I wish it was, but it wasn't. Okay, so then this is how math comes about, and then after you do this, you start coming up with some tools. There's some tools that start existing that, you know, are useful for calculating a cannonball, or drawing a perfect hexagon, or this, that, and the other, right? So there's a bunch of jumbled up noise, right? That are like integrals, or like circles, or pentagons, or, you know, like, what's another thing? Whatever, there's like a bunch of different triangles, or these could be not even shapes, I just use shapes because they're nice. Mathy stuff, but it's all jumbled, a bunch of tools that aren't really fit into any, you can't be really certain of their truth, they just seem to pragmatically work. And so, we discovered a really, really potent way of making this all cognitively nice. We port this over to an axiomatic tree. An axiomatic tree, watch my other video on this, I won't go too deeply into it, but you have some base level truths, so say it's like between any two lines, you can draw a circle, and then you go like this with it, right? And these are like your theorems. So you wanna minimize the amount of truths you have to accept on just faith, and then you prove it like this. And so you're trying to fit all these tools right into this kind of tree. So you find out what are the minimum truths we need to accept, and then let's fit this into a cognitive tree. So the history of mathematics effectively boils down to coming up with some tools or some generalizations, seeing some intuitions and whatnot, and then thinking about it for a long time and then porting it over to a mathematical tree. So when you observe a textbook, it just gives you this. So it doesn't give you the two steps before it of like environment, math, and then coming up with the tools and then porting it over. It just gives you like, here's some axioms, here's some theorems, and it all seems dry and dead. But it's not, it's actually very interesting. It's just, it's presented in a very dry way, unfortunately. Because it's not dry, math is very alive and it's very interesting. But yeah, environment, math, even more math, etc. Tools, kind of, it ends up like this. And we port it over, axiomatic tree. That is the presentation for the day, ladies and gentlemen. I will see you when I get home later, because I'm gonna go to the library and read. But bonus now, I only play this part if I haven't made an outro and it's like 3 a.m. just to save myself some time editing. If I haven't done an outro at home, this is gonna be the outro. So without further ado, take it easy. I love ya. Godspeed, and I will see you in the next one, which is going to be tomorrow. Math, ladies and gentlemen, do be how it is. Math's facts. Depending on if the axioms are real, which they might not be, which is very unsatisfying. Fucking math.